All right, buddy. So tell the people that haven't seen your part one, your name and where you're from.
Daniel, and I'm from Houston, Texas.
Daniel from Houston, Texas. Man, you got caught up in some crazy stuff, man. You were on the show. I almost got away with it.
Yeah.
You had a crazy, it was just crazy circumstances. You're a getaway driver, and some crazy things happened. I'll leave the link to part one pinned in the comment section description for people to check out. But the story's crazy, and you end up doing 20 years flat, well, 20 years and 2 days
right.
in Texas Department of Corrections, man, and we broke it down a little bit in part one. Hey, it was a good one. A lot of people liked it, man. You know, the video is actually on the higher end of the likes and comments, and so it's good, man. People
I saw in the comments a lot of people been waiting on something from Texas.
Hey, I know, man. I had one guy on here one time, but, you know, some people just tell stories better and just have a better personality. You know, it's just people click with them more often. You know what I mean?
Right.
How'd you feel about all the comments stuff? Did you get any kind of followers on Instagram or anything like that?
Man, they were swamping me because everybody's sending messages, trying to talk. And I'm trying to answer everybody. But, man, I was swamped, man. I don't know if I caught everybody or not yet. I still don't know if I'm caught up.
Yeah, man, I feel bad. I shouldn't feel bad, but I do because – a lot of good people message me, and I won't even be able to
read
them.
Oh, I can just imagine how yours is.
It's unbelievable, man. And it makes me feel bad because I want to help everybody. You know, when I first started the channel, I would heart everybody's comment, man. It's like a whirlwind, you know. It's hard to keep up with that. But audience, ladies and gentlemen, I love you. Death loves you, even if I don't reply.
You know, Daniel loves you too.
Daniel loves you too, man. Show him some love. Go check out his Instagram, and he's a tattoo artist now. Believe it or not. And dude, you do some pretty damn good work. Hey, show me what you just showed me before the video. Ladies and gentlemen, check out this tattoo gun. I've seen something like it, but not the battery pack.
Yeah, so this is the machine itself. And then you got a little battery pack. Ah, my hands are tired.
Yeah.
Put on there. I have to show you my hands later. I ain't got much muscle left in them, but.
Yeah, I heard you had surgery for
carpal tunnel.
Carpal tunnel. How'd you get that from tattooing?
Yeah.
That's crazy,
25
man.
Years.
That's why I don't tattoo that much. I'm going to tell you about it. But hey, raise it up a little bit. That thing's awesome, man. It's like a battery pack that you would see in prison.
Yeah, it's going.
That thing's cool, man. You know, I need to get me one of them on the road type of thing.
Yeah,
the campgrounds.
You can take it anywhere.
Yeah, start slinging ink at the campgrounds I visit.
Right.
What was I gonna say? Oh yeah, man, I don't tattoo too much. You know why? Because let's say I do a tattoo and it's like a 2.5-3 hour long tattoo.
Right.
Which ain't too long. You know what I mean?
No, it's not really.
Yeah. Some people like my back in prison. I was in the cell 9 hours straight getting it done. You know.
Yeah.
But my fingertips, man, they'll go numb and I won't feel them for like 3 or 4 days.
That's why you get these and you get this little rubber thing right here and see how wide it makes it. It's so much easier to hold this for a long time rather than that little pin barrel that you're holding. It's like holding this.
Yeah.
That's why your hand gets tired so fast. You get you a big grip, man, you can hold it all day.
Yeah. And I got
8 hour sessions, bro. You see my hand?
Yeah.
You see all the muscle gone?
Damn, dude. Is that what they do when you got carpal tunnel?
That's what caused it. Luckily, they caught it when they did, and I haven't lost any more muscle mass. But, yeah, they had to cut me open here and here, and this one had already started, so they got me here and here.
I mean, what exactly is it, though? I've heard it all the time. Motorcycle guys.
Yeah, really. For me, it was the vibration of the machines. And on top of that, I'm always like leaning on a table. So like the edges are always like right here when I'm drawing. And that was always hitting that nerve right there. So like when they opened me up right here, they took my funny bone, that nerve that runs through there that causes your funny bone to jump like that. And they put it on the other side. So now when I'm relaxed and on a table or drawing like that, I can't feel it. It doesn't hit that nerve anymore.
That's crazy, man.
Yeah.
That's unbelievable. Well, damn, dude. Yeah, like I think I just squeeze too hard when I do it too. You know what I mean?
I used to be like that too.
I squeeze really hard, man, for no reason. It just helps me stabilize a little bit, I guess. I don't know. I need to try that thing. That thing looks sweet, though.
See, that's why I don't hardly draw anymore. because a pencil and a pen is so small, my hand gets tired fast. It starts cramping on me. But holding this, it's so big that you're not going to squeeze it. You know, it's just sitting there.
Yeah.
Resting in your hand.
It's more of wrist action.
Yes.
You know, well, that's awesome, man. Well, since we're talking about tattoos and you did 20 years in the penitentiary, tell me, how the hell did your tattoo journey start, man? I remember when I first seen someone make the prison tattoo machine. I said, I got to get it.
Right.
And I screwed up. You know, the needle. I thought all you had to do was clip it and go.
I remember. I watched the video.
Oh, man, I scarred ourselves up, man. It was crazy. It was nothing but a scar. It was nothing but a scab. No ink was in there at all. It was actually, it was this one right here. It says Coast.
Yeah.
This is actually Scar, man. We had to
and
go over
it.
Went
back like, over it again?
Yeah, three more times. And the letters originally were not this big. They were like, you know.
Spread out.
Yeah. So we had to kind of freak it out a little bit. But it was bad, man. Tell me
how did you get it going? You know the ink nowadays, man, we could cover your arms completely. You know that, right?
I know, man.
I mean, they have good ink now,
See,
man.
That's what I want to do. I want to go to a shop, man, and just get as much of this shit fixed as possible, you know?
Yeah. Because, I mean, nowadays, it'll go right over that stuff.
Yeah, man, but it's like these guys charge so much money for cover-ups, you know?
Yeah, you need to come on down here to Houston.
I know, that's right.
I got you, bro.
I'll bless you, too, and blessing you would be like the normal price at a shop. You know what I mean?
Man, I ain't even worried about that. You blessed me by putting me on here and shouting out my Instagram, bro.
Nah, man. You know, I can't do that, man. I got to pay a little something. I'm just that kind of guy. But look, you never know, man. I got to go to Texas. I got to go down to the West Coast and make a big road trip. I'm waiting to get myself a death van.
Nice.
One of those little death transit trucks, man, you know, and just cruise the states with the death logo on there, man. You know, lockdown.
Put the old death of maniacs on the back so everybody can see it.
And look, I'm about to make a t-shirt like that. You know, I'm about to make a death of maniac t-shirt. And I don't know if y'all ever seen Animaniacs, but the character is going to look kind of like that, but tatted up.
Hell yeah.
It's going to be a sweet t-shirt, man.
Make some in black because I don't wear white, bro.
Yeah, I am. How long did it take for you to get into the tattoo game?
I was probably already tattooing within about 6 months of being down there. Like in county jail, in the pen, because in county jail, all they had was the stick and poke.
Yeah.
You know, and I didn't even try.
You don't have cards, you don't have TV, but you damn sure got a tattoo gun.
Oh yeah. Cause we make them. I don't know how to make a TV.
Yeah. Hey, look. Actually, you know what? Before we get into tattooing, I guess that jail that you mentioned is a pretty damn popular
gladiator school,
man.
It was pretty rough back in the game. I don't know how it is now. I haven't been there in so long. I mean, that was 28 years ago when I was in there, but it was rough back then.
Yeah, man. People are, I've heard of some people say, oh, no, they got TVs. But now I'm hearing, because you said they took out TVs and all that stuff in prisons.
And now in jail, they had one TV, but you had to go out to the day room. It wasn't in your cells.
Yeah. And you said they removed them in prison, right?
Yeah, well, I mean, they got the one in the day room, but they never had them in cells.
Yeah, no cell TVs and stuff like that.
No, we never had them while I was there.
Yeah, someone said, oh, man, they do. But look, I've read many more comments. They're like, this dude's legit. I got guys serving 3 life sentences still.
Well, you know what?
Day.
I told them in them comments, look, man, it's been 8 years since I've been down there.
Yeah.
You know, I've already been out for 8 years. So I imagine some stuff has changed. But I tell you what, I haven't heard from any of my homeboys down there that they have TVs yet.
Yeah, a lot of people co-signed, okay, to what you said. So it's good. It just depends. Some places might allow certain things, man. But,
right.
Yeah, man, everything that you've been saying, it's been checking out, and people loved it, and that's why people like it. You know, people from that state have been locked up, watch a show, they're hearing you. That's what people don't realize. Look, if there's any kind of fraudulent or any kind of bullshit in your story, there's going to be someone that's going to see it, you know? And typically, it's going to be way more of those kind of comments than the good ones, you know?
I know, that's right. I've seen it on them videos.
Yeah. But you're passing with flying colors, man. It's an amazing thing. And look, I appreciate you coming on the show once again, man. But look, Tattooing. Let's get back into tattooing, man. You get in there about 6 months into the pen.
Yeah, because I was drawing from the day I got there. Because I've always loved to draw. I've never taken any classes or anything, but I've just always loved to draw. You know, and I drew so much that I just started finally getting good. Yeah. You know, and everybody was telling me, man, you need to learn how to tattoo, man. The way you draw, you need to learn to tattoo.
Yeah.
I was like, man, I don't want to mess with that. But about 6 months later, they had me talked into it. I didn't have to build the machine, get the ink, nothing. They brought it all to me and said, come on, man, try it.
And damn, like you didn't have to do nothing, huh?
No, I didn't have, I mean, they put it in my hand going. I didn't even know nothing about it yet.
See, people don't understand, man. When you get to the pen, people are dying for tattoos.
Oh, yeah, man. Look, that's pretty much what just had me to where I could move between all the inner circles because I tattooed on everybody.
Yeah.
You know, so, I mean, it was easy for me to just kind of slide over here and talk to whoever. Something going over there, it ain't got nothing to do with me. I can still go over there and holler at them. You know,
exactly. That sounds like exactly how my bid was. My first
probably
bid, man.
Damn close.
Yeah,
probably damn and close.
And that's the kind of stuff that you can do when there ain't no crazy politics, some prisons, you know. But let's see here. Do you have any kind of crazy mess up stories or wild tattoo stories? Because I know I messed up a couple times in prison, man.
No, not really like mess ups. I was always just like, I mean, because I'm like a perfectionist.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I'm going to sit there and I don't care how long it takes me. I'm going to do it the way I want it done, you know?
Yeah.
But I tell you what, man, a couple times my man fell asleep at night and let me get walked up on. Boy, that sucks. Yeah, we were out. I had finally stayed out of trouble for a little while. So I'm out in the dormitories and the dude that's supposed to be watching for the law, you know, they only come in like once an hour, do a little walk around or whatever, you know? So he's supposed to be watching. He's sitting up in his bunk. I can see him, you know, because the cubicle walls are only like 3 foot tall. So, I mean, it goes like right here on him. So you can see him sitting up. So I just think he's watching. So I'm sitting here tattooing, no problem. And next thing you know, officer says, you might want to turn that off while I'm in here. And I thought it was my homeboy playing. I started laughing and just kept right on going. So I know I got somebody watching, so I know it ain't a law.
Yeah.
He said, and next thing you know, he said, did you hear me? And I looked, I was like, oh, hell. It was always, no, give it to me. Give it to me. I was like, all right. Hell. All you can do is give it to me. He didn't write me no case, though. He let me make it because he was laughing because my man was up there asleep, sitting up.
Yeah.
He's sitting up and done fell asleep, sitting up, man.
That's crazy, man. Look, one time I got caught. Look, I got caught red-handed. And he scared me so bad, just natural instinct. I hit the thing even though he saw me do the whole damn thing.
Was it still going?
No, it was off. I had a kill switch, but still, it was scared the hell out of me, man. You know, I was still in that convict state of mind. Hell, hide the shit. Yeah. Hide it. Hide it.
Well, that is not a good feeling.
Man. But that's crazy. You know, I messed up a tattoo on someone's neck. I put the pattern on with him like this. So when I tatted it.
Oh, and he went back normal.
It was all smushed together, and it was like his daughter's name or some shit. I can't remember what it was, but it was something important.
He got to walk around like this the rest of his life, man.
Oh, man, I'll never forget it. It ain't my damn fault, though. Look.
I tell you what, one of my homeboys, he was kind of like one of the ones that taught me a little bit about tattooing. I had already been tattooing when we fell in the same block, but he was better than me. So he was schooling me on some different things. And one day this dude wanted gangster put on his back and he left the dang N out and it just said G-A-G-S-T-A.
Gangster, oh my God.
And he did it about this big all the way across this dude's back, man. There ain't no way to fix that. That
dude. I did almost like something that. Like that too, man. I did almost something like that too on a girl. Man. Well, I didn't almost do it. I did it.
Really?
I was out here in the streets. It was this girl. She wanted chocolate on her lower back.
Yeah.
And I spelled it chocolate. I forgot the A or some shit in there. I told her before I did. I said, I don't know how to spell chocolate. Anybody know how to spell chocolate in here?
Man, you got a phone. Google that shit.
Yeah, man, we were drunk, high, all kinds of stuff,
that's
man.
That's the problem.
So I was just slinging, man. But it came out good, you know? I don't think anybody, I didn't even notice it even after it was done. They messaged me like 2 days later. The thing spelt wrong.
Right.
Say, it took about a day for him to realize.
Man, it took about four of the dude's homeboys before somebody realized that he misspelled gangster.
Oh my God.
He's showing it off, looking in the mirror. He don't even notice it. Like the first three people he showed it, they didn't even notice.
Yeah.
But the fourth person was like, what? Dude, he forgot a letter, man. And there ain't no fixing that. And then he went to looking in the mirror. Oh, he was going crazy.
Look at this shit. Look at this shit. What do you see on the back of my neck? Tell me what you see. Do you see the word cities?
Just barely, brother. Huh. Is it like the lower part?
Can you see? It's like, it should be like.
Oh, right. Yeah. Now I can see it. Yeah.
Okay. That shit's misspelled, man.
Oh, is it? You can't tell?
I don't even know what the hell, how it's spelled on my neck. I can't remember, but it's misspelled. It says sit ties instead of cities.
Damn it, man.
Yeah, so I kind of been telling people, you know, some bullshit. Yeah, it was meant to be like that.
Right.
It was meant to be like that.
Man. Yeah, you need to make a trip down here, man.
I got some bullshit on me, man. But it is, you know how it is in prison, man.
I was just on Rapping Mike's channel yesterday. I see he's putting out some videos.
Yeah,
I told him he needs to teleport his ass down here and get a tattoo from me.
I tried, man. I tried a million times to get him to do a tat. He don't want him. He wants his body pure.
That's abnormal nowadays.
Yeah. It is. Mike is different.
Yeah, you can tell. He seems all right, dude, though, man.
But he's good. Yeah, man, he's good, peoples, man. He's one of the best cellmates I ever had, man. Entertaining is...
Yeah, I could have dealt with him as a cellie easy.
Yeah, he's a good dude, man. But, all right, man, so you're tattooing in the penitentiary. You're tattooing all kinds of people. You're jumping around in the mix and stuff like that. Do you have any kind of... What was some of the crazier things or... I got two questions for you.
All right.
Okay, you can answer either or and whenever you want. I want to know what was probably one of your scariest moments in prison where you might have felt like, hey, shit might happen to me.
Right.
And also, what was one of the wildest things you might have seen in prison?
All right, well.
It could be violent or non-violent, just anything, just absolutely wild.
All right, we'll go with, probably the most violent that I just witnessed firsthand. I mean, within just a couple of feet from me, man. This dude's trying to become a member of an organization. So they tell him that they just X somebody out. So he has to take them out to get in. So we're in the chow hall and he's like two people in front of us. And he sees the dude that got X'd out sitting at the table. He's already eating. And he's like, oh, we see him get out of line. And it's me and my homeboy Solo, man.
Solo.
Yeah. So we're sitting there watching him because we already know what's going down. So we're watching. And he goes over behind the dude, pulls his man, nice knife out, man. It's probably like a foot, but the handle makes the blade probably about 8 inches.
Yeah.
I mean, and he rears back and then just stops. He just froze. He couldn't do it. And Solo, he's so damn crazy. He's got like probably two life sentences and then some time stacked on that. He just don't give a damn, right?
Yeah.
And he hates gang members. I'm talking about hates them. So he goes up behind the dude that's supposed to be doing the work, grabs the knife out of his hand, hits him first, and then hits the dude that he was supposed to be hitting. Walks out of the chow hall, throws the damn shank down, and gets on the fence. I didn't see him again for 8 years because he was in SEG.
And he had nothing to do with any of it.
Nothing to do with any of it. He just tripped smooth out, man. He just didn't care. He said, man, I hate the gang members. Watch this. And I'm talking about, he just went off. And I mean, I knew he was in there for murder. I knew he was a killer. But damn, you don't never expect no shit like that, bro. We've been hanging out for a couple years.
He had a bad day.
He woke
up on the wrong side of the map, my friend.
Dude, just out of nowhere.
But you know, some people are like that, dog. They if they don't like something so much, they snap. I talk about this all the time, you know. I know you've seen stuff like this, okay? You go to prison, there's weaker individuals that might get preyed upon all the time, but not too much to where they're like, I got to leave the block. You know, they're just getting picked on or they might...
Right.
In
rent.
Yeah, or they shut their mouth even after they get talked too crazy.
Yeah.
And they just, you know, just let it go because they know they'll get freaking demolished. But
right.
Every now and then you see they snap. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
They snap and you never knew that they were capable of doing such things.
They probably didn't even know it at the time.
They didn't, man. It's like an animal or a demon or something that unleashed within them. It's like years and years of buildup of being picked on, and boom, you know. And I've also seen
it's like you finally backed them into that corner.
Yeah, that's
you know, there's no man. There's no more flight. You can't go anywhere. So I mean, you ain't got no option but to fight.
That's it, man. And I've seen the flip side too. You know, dudes would just snap, and they should never have snapped. They should have just kept low key because they just got punished just because they got a little too aggravated that day and thought that they were gonna do something.
Yeah, you know? Stepped out of line a little bit.
Yeah. So that's crazy. That's a crazy ass story, man. That's probably it was a very short story, but for real.
Yeah.
It's very wild. You know what I mean?
I tell you what, it happened real fast.
Yeah. That's crazy, man.
Man, I didn't even tell my mom about that until probably like, man, maybe a month ago. And I've been out for 8 years.
That's wild as shit, dude.
Yeah.
What prison was that in?
Oh man, that was on Telford Unit.
Telford Unit?
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know any of these names, but throughout time, I'm trying to remember all these notorious prisons.
It was one of the crazy ones when we first opened it because, man, all they did was bring a bunch of youngsters that are closed custody and medium custody, and they threw us all on B-side, and the prison was wide open. The guards were all brand new because it's just opening.
Yeah.
You know, it's a brand new prison. There's still plastic on the toilets and the tables and stuff that you got to peel off.
Yeah. You know,
that's how new it is. Nobody's even been in the cells. And, man, they opened that thing, and all they had was a bunch of crazy-ass youngsters that had been getting trouble on other units, so they shipped them over here to open this one. Man, it was buck wild for probably, like, the first 2 years.
Yeah. There was a prison out here called Pocahontas, and my homeboy DC went up there, and I was keeping in contact with him because he moved from the prison I was in, Greensville, to Pocahontas, and I was still keeping in contact with him through three ways and stuff. I don't know where he is to this day, but anyways – he got to Pocahontas, brand new prison, just like that.
Right. And
within just a couple days, the whole shit was on lockdown, man. Inmates took over the whole thing. And I tried to break it down, like, maybe, you know, you would think a brand new prison, security and stuff, and COs, it would be pretty secure, but they really, you have to let the population flow to see its flaws. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So it's just like fixing a car. You know, you never know what's going to happen until you turn it on.
And
it could blow up or it could run smooth as hell.
Right.
And that's what happened. It blew up and locked it down. Now they got an order. Pocahontas Penitentiary. Y'all do your research on that. It's a fairly new prison. But yeah, that's crazy, man, how they open up prisons and send people there to crank them up.
Yeah, and this was one of them new school ones, you know. It wasn't like the long cell block with the bars in the front and all that. It's like rooms almost that you're in. But they would leave the doors open from 7 in the morning till 10 at night.
Yeah.
You know? So, I mean, it was buck wild because anybody could just go anywhere at any time. All them officers were so green, it was crazy.
Yeah.
You know, you could talk them out of any case when we first got there. You know, just talk just a little bit. They were all falling for that conversation.
Yeah. Hey, look, man. Come on, man. I'm so starving, man. Come on, dude. I'm not going to have no commissary, man. Come on. All right.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. They were so green, it was hilarious. I mean, there was times like, we didn't have anything over there yet, you know, because we don't know any maintenance crews. Everybody just got there. Nobody really knows anybody unless they came from your unit with you, you know.
Yeah.
So we're over there and we're like, man, how are we going to make some tattoo machines, man? And my buddy's like, let's go to the kitchen. I was like, what? He said, man, they call out workers every day. We'll just act like we're minimum custody. We'll go with them. Well, they didn't have any work roster or nothing. They're just writing your name down as you go in, right? So we just gave them our name. We went in there. We went in the scullery, opened up the dishwashing machine. There's six relays right there. We took all of them. That's six motors right there.
Really? I never even heard that before.
Look, when they start running chow, they think we're working in the scullery. The scullery won't even work because we just stole all the relays out of the machine. So they're telling us.
Well, what is it, like a dishwasher?
Yeah, it's just a big dishwasher that they put all the trays in, just the trays, the cups, and the spoons, and you just run it through there.
And what'd you say, a scullery?
Yeah, that's where it's at. That's where you, like, dump your tray when you get up.
I mean, not scullery. What'd you say you took?
Oh, we took the relays.
Yeah, what is that?
Okay, that's like the clackers that are out here, the Free World tattoo machines.
Yeah.
The loud ones, the little motors on there, they don't spin. It's it's electromagnetic.
Yeah.
And that's what we were getting, them kind of motors. Because we were building, like, the clacker machines like they have out here.
That's crazy, man.
There was a few people in there that used spinners like yours.
Yeah.
That's what we call those spinners. But that's most people liked relays because, I don't know, you can make it a lot quieter and you don't have to, like, run it off of your radio and stuff like that to make the voltage go down.
Yeah, we had universal adapters for our...
Oh, did you?
Yeah, so it went from like 3.5 volts to 9 volts. And nice. Depending on what device you had, because they had multiple electronical devices like TV, beard trimmer, radio, right. stuff like that. So it was a universal adapter for all of them that they sold.
Right.
And it was a beautiful piece of work, my friend.
Yeah, that's nice.
Yeah.
Speaking like speaking of that, of like dropping your voltage and stuff, on part one, you hit me up about the water in the tattoo machines.
Yeah, that's what I was about to ask you, man. You read my mind. Let me hear this, because my homeboy's locked up right now. He's saying they're doing it in there, but he hasn't gotten close enough to really see how it works, you know? And okay. I haven't even read anything on
well,
it.
Well, see, for us, we don't have any of them voltage-regulating plugs
yeah.
at all on any of our appliances. So what they would do is they would run a plug that they've cut off an appliance, plug it into the wall, and you run it to a cup of water, fill the cup of water up, and you put the two wires in there, the negative and the positive. Just don't let them touch. And then the wire from your machine, you put the negative and positive in the water. And the current will leave these wires and go to the other ones, but it drops your amps and your voltage down to where you're not blowing up the machine, because it's not 110 coming out of there when it hits that water.
Oh, that's what you okay. So you're before. Talking about a different water technique than what I'm thinking. So in order to use that voltage, you had to have the water lower the voltage.
Yeah, because if your machine's not 110, 110's coming out of that wall, so you can't plug it up direct. Because they That's have crazy. 24-volt machines, and it can only handle 24 instead of 110. And if you stick it in the water, you can run it safe without it blowing up. But you That's plug it in the cool. wall, it'll melt it.
I never knew that. See, I'm thinking about the water one where they're actually – The whole needle is moved by the water pressure from the sink, coming out the sink.
Oh, hell no, that's too new for me.
Look, it's insane, man. Somehow the water coming out the sink puts pressure on something and it rotates the needle up and down, dude. It's unbelievable. No electricity whatsoever, just straight. Because you know them sinks, I don't know if you've seen sinks, but you can jam things in the sink knob sink will constantly run.
Yeah.
And if you want to cook a soup, you let that shit run for an hour and the water will be scalding, you know?
Yeah.
So that's how they did it. I got to see how.
That's crazy, man. Yeah, that sounds like some hydraulics action.
That's pretty much all it is, man.
That's crazy. No, that's too new for me. Yeah, yeah. When you find out, I want to see the video on that.
Yeah. I'm going to read about it, man. I'm going to try to, what is it? Duplicate it out here in the streets somehow with a hose
That's
or
crazy,
something. I don't
yeah.
know, but
dang.
Let me see here.
I thought I was doing good with a battery pack. They're using water. Hell,
I've never seen it, man. But a lot of people been telling me about it. My homeboy just told me about it, so I thought for sure that's what you were talking about. But this is a whole new technique, and that's very smart, you know, to lower the voltage by putting the water. You know,
in a cup. Yeah,
it's very smart, man. Never
yeah, that's the only
that.
Way to do it. If you because we don't have any of them plugs where you can regulate the voltage on them. It doesn't do all of our appliances just plug in the wall.
Yeah,
I mean, hell, we don't have many to start with. I mean, you can get a radio, a fan, a hot pot, and a nightlight. That's about the only things you're going to get that plug in.
Yeah, that's crazy. Them nightlights. I miss them little nightlights.
Yeah,
it'd be so relaxing at night. Have the little nightlight, and I'd be drawing, or I'd be just reading. Man, it's so peaceful. Freaking 3 a.m. Independence Century.
That's about the only time.
That's about the only damn time, boy. But let me see. Hey, have you ever seen cells? Okay, because I was in a cell like this, and a lot of people say they can't believe they think I'm lying. Okay, but a lot of people have seen it. Have you ever seen the cells where they had buttons in them, emergency buttons, with intercoms and everything?
No, but I heard that they have some of them in Texas now.
Yeah.
They're the, I guess maybe like the brand new prisons that they started building have them, because we were starting to hear about them even before I got out in 2012.
Yeah.
I guess they were starting to do them back then.
Yeah, I was in a prison where they had this emergency button. I think it was on 60 days into a jail had it, because this guy was having some medical problems and he pressed emergency button and they were talking to him.
Yeah, that's crazy. You know what? Because I heard that, like, if there's a female up there, well, she ain't going to get no rest, because everybody's got that button in their cell and that little speaker. They're all trying to talk to her.
Yeah.
So if something really does happen, she's going to ignore it, because she's tired of people messing with her within the first hour or so.
Yeah.
You know, that's messed up, really.
Yeah. And look, this is another thing. People think it's all about emergency. It ain't about the emergency, my friend. It ain't just about emergency. Them damn intercoms, when they crank them on, they hear everything.
Oh, yeah. That's right.
They are listening to everything you're saying. So there was this one cell, man. I'll never forget. I was in this cell with, it was some, I think he was a GD, man. But they had this, they had the speaker thing and the little button in the cell. And every time, like, it would make a popping sound sometimes, like it was coming online.
Yeah, you can hear it come on. Yeah. That's how ours was too.
And we were so paranoid. Every time that shit popped on, we would just shut the hell up. You know what I mean?
We could hear it like where our cells were. They didn't have any kind of thing like that in the cell. But outside the cell, they had their intercoms.
Yeah.
And them speakers, they have speakers in them too. And you can hear it come on, you know?
Yeah.
Just barely. I mean, you got to be listening for it. If you're jamming or whatever, you ain't going to hear it. Yeah. But I mean, if you're just sitting there and you're quiet, just reading or something, you can hear just the faint little click. And that means that officer up there can hear anything on the pod.
Yeah. Yeah. And them cameras too, man. Them things were, look, I got caught tattooing by one of them cameras. Look, it is crazy, man. That thing zoomed in like right onto the damn needle. You know what I mean?
Look in your cell, huh?
It's crazy. This was in a dorm. This was in a dorm when that happened. Yeah. But in the cell, I always just got caught by damn correctional officers walking past when my guards weren't.
Nobody watching out.
Yeah, my lookouts. I just called them my guards. My lookouts. And that's when I started paying for my lookouts because you don't pay someone, they're going to slack their ass off.
They man. Yeah. I fell asleep a couple times sitting up. I mean, I'm looking back. I swear he's watching because he's sitting up. Got me a couple times like that.
Yeah, that shit's crazy, man. But look, man, you got any anything else you might want to say about Texas Penitentiary before we head on out?
Man.
What would you say is some of the best information you could tell someone that might be going in there?
Man, just be a man. I mean, that's all you got to do. You ain't got to go in there and try to make a name for yourself. Or nothing. Just be a man, you know? And I'm going to tell you, don't try to do your time with one foot out that door. You know, because if you got 2 years or 20 years, you got to go all in.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, don't catch body or nothing, but I mean, you got to be down, you know, you got to fight for yourself. That way ain't nobody taking your shit every month when you get money, you know?
Yeah.
But really the best advice is just don't do any dirt, man.
Yeah.
And I'll tell you what, the best advice I can give you, if you're stepping out and you really want to stay out of trouble, man, find like-minded people. Because if you go to hanging out with the same people that are still getting in trouble, you're going to get right back into it. What you need to do.
The same feather flock together, my friend.
That's right. What you need to do is find you a good woman that's going to hold you accountable for your decisions that you're making.
For sure.
Because I've got one. She's held me down for 8 years. You know?
That's what's up, man.
So, I mean, you find you a good woman that ain't just going to let you run wild and do what you want to do, get in trouble, you're going to be all right.
Yeah, it's typically the bad boys go for those kind of people. You know, it's weird. The bad guys, they need that damn.
You need somebody that's going to hold you accountable, not just ride with you and do whatever.
Exactly.
You
know?
Because that's when you start getting in trouble. You don't want them yes people around you all the time. You know, because eventually you're going to be thinking something wrong, you know, and you don't want them to yes that. You want people that are going to hold you accountable and make you sit your butt down somewhere.
I know that's for sure, man.
Because it ain't worth it. Look out, man. I lost 20 years. There is nothing worth me going back for.
Yeah.
Nothing. You know?
That's right.
You would have to either attempt or kill one of my family members before I would even think about it.
Yeah.
You know, nothing else is worth it. I don't care what it is. It's not worth it. Man, they already got 20 from me. Hell, I'm just now catching up and having 20 out here.
I know.
I was only 17 when I went down. I did more time than I had in the free world.
Yeah.
So, I mean, shit, it ain't worth it, man. It just ain't worth it.
That's crazy, man. But that's some good information. You know, what I liked what you said, and this is very important, ladies and gentlemen, you can't have one foot in prison, one foot in the streets. It will drive you insane.
Yeah, no, you got to go all in.
Yeah, if you're in prison, man, I tell you this all the time, your mind has to flip.
That's
your world. You better freaking focus on it 100% or else it's going to eat you alive, man.
That's right.
Good.
And the same thing goes when you step out. You got to flip your mind all over again. Because if you come out here expecting the respect and the notoriety that you had in there, it ain't happening. Nobody knows you out here. Ain't no respect out here hardly anymore.
And a lot of people come out thinking that that's what's going
to
happen.
That's right. Say, I'll tell you, man, it's a trip. You have to flip your whole mind frame. you know, because you're used to walking around in there, especially, I mean, if you're cool with a bunch of people, you know, and you can talk to whoever you want to talk to, do what you want to do. You got a little bit of notoriety because you're tattooing, you know. People want to be around that so they can ease up in there, get in line, you know. And then you step out here and don't nobody know you. Don't nobody care about none of that crap, you know. Yeah. It's just a completely different world. So, I mean, if you get caught up in that trying to prove yourself out here because you were a gangster in there, oh, you're in trouble from jump.
Yeah. A lot of people, man, they go back because they have that notoriety in there. And when they come on the streets, they ain't got shit.
That's right. You know? Yeah, out that's here, people out here, people bump into you and not even say, excuse me. You know, yeah. In there, people bump into you and then see who they bump into. And if you're about, they're like, hey, that's my bad, bro. Yeah. You know, that's my bad, man.
That's my bad. Yeah. My bad.
I mean, damn, man.
Yeah.
They don't know you're a killer, you know?
Yep. That shit's crazy, man. But look, you went. I would like to do, you know, I have fun chatting with you, man. And I see that, you know, you went through some things out here in the street. You're going through the surgeries and all that with your stuff, man. I would like to have you on for part three, man. Maybe talk a little more about the prison later on down the road and a little more about what you're doing out here in the streets, if you don't mind.
All right, man. I got a good story for you from 2015 when I was on the streets.
Really?
Oh, yeah. I went into a coma, so we'll just leave it at that.
Yeah, we'll save that for a part three, man. But look, I appreciate you coming back on, man. It's been a pleasure, I must say.
I appreciate you having me, brother. I enjoy chopping it up with you, man.
Hey, man. You're welcome anytime, my friend. And ladies and gentlemen, I'll leave his Instagram pinned in the comment section below. Go check out his artwork, man. You're very talented, you know, and it's amazing what us convicts can do, man. You know,
I'm self-taught. You know, I just learned down there. I mean, I had plenty of free time, you know, so what else? You know, I wanted to take something from there that I could use out here to make money.
Damn right.
You know? I didn't want it to be hustling. You know, I didn't want it to be hustling. I didn't want to do dirt. You know, I wanted to come out here and do it the right way.
I know that's right, man.
And that's the one thing that I could take with me is that art. Because people love art. They always love art, you know.
Yeah. You should check out my Etsy page, man. I sell a lot of artwork on there as well.
I just watched two of your videos where you were building them boards. Yeah, I haven't seen you paint one yet, but I was watching you cut them out and sand them down and stuff.
Yeah, I usually do all the shaping. And my father, he's an even better artist than me. Not at tattooing. but other stuff, man. He's very talented. And it's crazy because, you know, before we end, ladies and gentlemen, you know, my father's always been talented with art, you know. And it's crazy how back in the day he could barely afford anything. And he was doing everything. He was doing cutouts of like storks and selling it to people to put in their front yard if they had a baby. You know, he was cutting out plywood and hustling like that when I was a little kid. And it never really amounted to anything but his talent, man. He loved it and he made it happen. And now he has
stuck
his own damn
it.
Art business, dude. And man. He's killing it, you know?
Yeah, that's what they tell you. Don't give up on your dreams, even if you have to do something else until it starts paying off. Don't give up, man. You can make it if you're passionate about it, you can make it.